गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, सो हियर क्वेश्चन, हियर वी आर गिवन हियर थ्री स्मॉल बॉल्स ए बी एंड सी. Each of them are having masses of m, m and 2m here. That is, A and B are having masses m and m, and C is having a mass of 2m. They are connected by identical inextensible and light strings, and they are placed on a frictionless horizontal surface. Okay, the strings are initially just a top, and the angle between them is given to be 60 degrees, theta equal to 60. Okay. Now the ball A is imparted a velocity u in the x direction, that is in the rightward direction, which you can consider as x direction, parallel to the string BC. Okay, the initial velocity is parallel to string BC. Okay, and this velocity u is given to ball A by a sharp impulse. Okay, now we have to find velocity VC, velocity of ball C VC, with which it begins to.
u by 19, sir.
U by
19.
U by 19.
19.
19. Okay.
Sir, u by 21.
U by 21.
Yes, sir.
U by 22.
Okay. So all got different answers.
Sir, U by 22, obviously.
U by 22?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, right. So in the given like question, okay, this angle is given to be theta. Angle between AB and BC. So the strings are inextensible, and initially A is given a velocity in the x direction. So as soon as A is given a velocity, A will move in a straight line. It moves. Because as soon as it is given a velocity, it will not experience any tension because the string will become slack. Okay, the string will become slack. And then it will just move straight till it reaches this point. Where this length is again the same as this. And this length and this length becomes same. Till then, it will move in a straight line. And then all of a sudden, the string will become taut. The string AB will become taut. And velocity of A will abruptly change. Because there will be an impulse developed in this string. Due to impulse developed in string AB, velocity of A will abruptly change. Okay. Now, just before this string has become taut, velocity of this A was new. Okay. Now, just after the string has become taut, the velocity along the string will change. Okay, so if A will have some velocity this way, along the string, and A will have some velocity perpendicular. Okay, so along the string, let us consider it to be un. And perpendicular to the string, we can consider it to be. Okay, I'm taking the velocities of A. Just after the string has become taut, just after string AB has become taut, along the string and perpendicular string, that UN and U. Now this UT is not going to get affected by the impulse, because impulse acts along the string, so there will not be any effect on this component of velocity perpendicular to the string. So that should be the same as what it was before the impulse is acted. Okay. So the component of initial velocity along this tangential direction, or along this direction perpendicular to the string, that will be. Because if this angle is theta, then this is also theta. This angle also will be theta. So component of u along the string will be u cos theta. And component perpendicular to string, the ut, should be u sin. Okay. So just before the string became taut, it was u cos theta. After the string became taut, it became un. Okay. So along the string, we can say for A, momentum has changed because of an impulse. So let us say impulse J1x. Impulse J1x. So impulse J1 can be considered to be equal to a decrease in momentum along the string. Okay, because along the string, if there was a momentum directed away from this B, then that momentum has obviously decreased because of this impulse J1 acting in the opposite direction. So that J1 can be equated to decreasing momentum. And which will be nothing but mu sin theta minus n. Okay, so mu sin theta minus mun. This is one equation which we can get for impulse J.
Sir, mu cos theta.
Yes.
Should it be mu cos theta?
Mu cos theta.
Mu cos. Yes. Mu cos. Yeah. And for B, we can now look for B also.
For B, there can be two components of velocity. We can say one component of velocity is Vx, another component is. So just after the impulse is acted, B will have two components of velocity, Vx and Vy. Okay, Vx is parallel to BC and Vy is perpendicular. Okay, we can say that net impulse acting in x direction on B should be equal to change in momentum of B in x direction. So which means MVx should be equal to, now mass of A and B are given to be M only, so I'm taking it as MVx. MVx is equal to the net impulse in x direction, which will be component of J1, because for B we can say that J1 will act like this and J2 will act. Okay, so J1 will act at an angle of theta with the x-axis. So it should be J1 cos theta minus J. Okay, second equation will be this. And one equation we can get for C also. For C only J2 will act. So impulse J2 acting on C can be equated to change in momentum of C. So change in momentum of C will be mass of C into x final velocity. So J2 equal to 2m. Into VC. The other equation. Okay, we can also form a few more equations using constraints. A and B along the string, after the string has become taut, there should be no relative velocity between A and B along the string. So along the string, A and B will not have any relative velocity. So velocity of A along the string and velocity of B along the string should be. Okay, so how do we get that relation? We can get the relation simply like this. Un should be equal to, Un is velocity along the string for A, and velocity along the string for B will be resultant of Vx and Vy along the string. So we will take component of Vx along the string and Vy also along the string and add them. Okay, so that should be Vx cos theta plus Vy cos theta. I have not taken theta as 60 degrees in this so far. We can do that finally also. After getting some general expression, we can substitute theta equal to 60 finally. Or else you can put theta equal to 60 right here itself if you want to make the calculations simpler. Okay. So un is Vx cos theta plus Vy like sine theta. That is one relation. And one more relation you can also establish here is for this string. Along the string, for B and C also, there should be no relative. So there is no relative velocity for B and C along the string, which means velocity of B along the string and velocity of C along the string should be equal. So Vx must be equal to Vc.
Sir, can we write MVy must be equal to J1 sine theta?
MV? MV?
For mass B, sir.
Mass B, what do you want to write?
J1 sin theta must be equal to MV by
J1. Yes, we have to write that also. For one more equation we haven't written here, y direction for me. Yes, because I've written my equation for x direction for me, I have to write one equation in y direction also. And in the y direction, the impulse acting will be J1's y component, that is J1 sin theta. So J1 sin theta should be equal to MV. This is 6. So we have 6 equations. Okay, so 6 unknowns are there in this here, because we have unknowns as U1, Un is one unknown, and Vx and Vc, Vx, Vc and Vy, those makes it 4 unknowns, and then we have J1. Of course, although it looks like there are 6 unknowns, but many unknowns can be eliminated right away by just looking at the equations, because you can see Vx and Vc are same only. So they are basically the same variable. So you don't need one separate variable as well. So effectively, number of equations that you need to solve are not 6, but they are maybe 3 or 4 equations. Okay. So then you can determine what is this.
Sir, one more way we can do, same thing only, sir.
Yeah.
Taking first along AB, sir, if we say J1, J2 are the two impulses,
okay. Then
net velocity of B along AB should be net velocity of A along AB, no, sir.
net velocity of B along AB should be equal to net velocity of A along AB.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So, if we write some equation like velocity of B along AB is J2 cos theta, J2 sin theta minus... So
basically, you are trying to resolve impulse along the string and taking the resultant along the string, and that you are equating it to momentum of B along the string, right? You can do that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And then it's doing the same thing along BC also.
I exactly did the other way of it. I took impulses and I took velocity components. But instead, you're considering velocity of A along the string and B along the string are equal only. So that both of them are represented by one variable only. And you are taking impulses components along.
Yes, sir.
Okay, but then you should also consider that B will have a velocity perpendicular to string.
Yes, sir. I am not worrying about that velocity only, sir, then. Because anyways, we need to find J2 only, no, sir.
Yeah.
So once we are able to find J2, it doesn't matter what velocity of P is.
Once you find J2, then you can find what is PC also, because J2 equal to 2 meters.
Yes, sir.
Yes, that we can do, because we can find J2 from that equation. Equation you write for a longer string for this means.
Yes.
So doing this way, I think you will get finally BC equal to U by 19, right?
So U by 22.
U by 22. Okay.
Yes.
But that means something which you will get after you take theta as 60 degrees. But if you if you keep it as theta only, then you will get something in terms of theta.
We get U cos theta by 11 for this case.
U cos theta by 11.
Yes.
Okay, is it clear?
Sir?
Yes.
In the first equation where you wrote J1 is equal to mu cos theta minus mu normal, you took J1 to be positive, but J1 is the tension impulse, right? It's acting opposite to the direction of change in velocity. You should take minus J1, right?
Right. So I'll take minus J1 and I'll reverse the center. Then it should be perfect.
Why would you reverse the change sign? Because...
If this is your positive direction,
yes, sir.
Right now, the impulse should be change in momentum, right? Final minus initial momentum. But I have taken here initial minus one.
Ah, okay, sir. Yeah, sorry, sir. I didn't notice that. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Fine. Sir. Got it. Sir.
That's why I was emphasizing on the point decrease in momentum. That was really, I did not use the term change in momentum.
Yeah, sir. Fine. Sir. I got it. Sir. Thank you. Sir.
Okay, so the next question we have here. There are four identical small blocks which are numbered as 1, 2, 3 and 4. Okay, they are moving in the same direction with velocities V and they are moving along the same line. Okay, on a frictionless horizontal surface towards a rigid vertical wall, as you can see in the figure. Okay, now separations between 1 and 2 is A, but 2 and 3 is given to be B and 3 and 4 is given to be C. Okay. If all the collisions are given to be perfectly elastic, whether it may be between the wall and the block or between between the blocks, they are all elastic ones. Okay. We have to find the velocities of all the four balls and the separations between each blocks just after all the possible collisions.
The same velocities and the same separations.
Okay.
The order might get reversed.
Okay.
Sir, the boxes are numbered 1, 2, 3. Yes, sir. So, 1 and 2 will have C, 2 and 3 will have B, 3 and 4 will have A.
Okay.
So, when the last collision happens, 2 blocks should have 0 separation also.
Just after the last collision, we want to find the separation. The collision means the collision doesn't have to be between blocks only, they can be between blocks and wall also.
Okay.
So we can take it like an elastic collision is simply interchangeable.
Yeah. If the masses are same.
Yes. So it doesn't matter whether it is just one will continue its trajectory whether there was a collision or not. Yes.
Yes. In the same question, also try to figure out the total number of collisions in all.
So total number of collisions?
Yes. Okay.
So 10 collisions.
10 collisions.
Sir, should we include collisions with wall, sir?
Can you be a little louder? I can't clearly hear.
Sir, should we include collisions with wall also, sir?
Yes, all, as I said, all possible collisions, they are all elastic only. And after all those possible collisions, we want to find velocities and separations. And we also can find how many collisions will take place in all.
Okay, sir.
Said 10 collisions.
Yes.
10 collisions total.
10 collisions. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, 10 collisions altogether, no? Including collisions with wall also.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, so this is a given question. All the four are moving towards the wall with the same speed v and along the same line. Separations between them are given like this. Okay, so here you want to find final velocities of all the four balls after all the collisions have taken place, and also the separations just after all the collisions have taken place. Okay, so here we are including collisions with ball also.
Okay, but since all of them are having same velocities and they are given to be identical masses, so like there are two things I think we can clearly keep in our mind before we proceed in solving this. One thing is, like, if there is a wall and if a body is moving with a velocity v and it's undergoing elastic collision, it will just return back with the same velocity. Okay, so it will just hit the wall and return back with the same velocity. Okay, so that is something which we know. Okay, another thing which we can also use here is that if there are two bodies which are moving in opposite directions with same speeds and if they have same masses, suppose this is A and this is B. Okay, I've taken two blocks A and B having same speeds in opposite directions and the masses are same. If there is a collision, elastic collision between them, then we know that when identical masses undergo elastic collisions, the velocities get interchanged. That means the A velocity B will have and the B velocity A will have after collision. So if this is before collision, then after collision it will be like this. After interchanging of velocities, it will be like this, because B's velocity is V towards left, now A has, and A's velocity is now possessed by B. Okay, so this is what is generally happening whenever we consider elastic collision between two identical masses. Okay, now in this, what we are able to conclude is that as a result of collision, A's velocity has been given to B. Therefore, now B moves in such a way as what A would have moved. If there would have been no collision, then B would move in a way how A would have moved. And similarly, like A would now move in a way how B would have moved if there would have been. In simple ways, I can say that B is going to follow the trajectory of A, and A is going to follow the trajectory of B after this. Right? Or this can be actually thought of as another way. There is another way of looking at it. You can also say that as a result of this collision, it can be thought of as A is just going past B, or B is just going past. So there's a collision between two bodies and it's like they are just going past with no changes in their velocity. Okay, the situation is going to be similar to that. Okay, whenever we have a collision between identical bodies in going in opposite directions with equal velocities. Okay, so keeping this point in mind, okay, what we will do. We will consider that A moving this way, this body one will collide with the wall, and after collision it will rebound. So it rebounds, it's going to be like this after first collision. It's going to be 1. And we have 2 here. Okay, 2, 3 and 4 are still moving in the same directions, but 1's velocity has got reversed after the first collision. Okay, now 1 will collide with the 2. Now, as I told you, since the collision is elastic and the two bodies are traveling in opposite directions, so it can be thought of as good as 1 is just going past. Okay, and similarly, then if it collides with 3, then it can be imagined as if it is going past 3. And then if it collides with 4, it can be imagined as if it is going past 4. Okay, so basically, and it will maintain the speed V throughout. Even like after collision, it will continue to move the same. If it crosses B and if it passes 2, 3 and 4 with speed. Okay, so there's one way of looking at it, that one just goes with the speed V through all these three particles and just comes off this case and it moves up. Actually, it is not something like that, but it can be viewed like that in this case, a situation. Why? Because how one we are moving, that motion is now going to be followed by 2, which will collide with 2, and then 2 will impart velocity to 3, so 3 will start moving this way and it will collide with 4, and then 4 will be forced to move. So eventually you will have 4 actually moving. Okay, after all those collisions. Okay, but we can also rule it as like one movie through all these problems. Okay, but then when one was here, two was here, and the distance is a. So gap between one and two is a. Now, since they are all going to move with constants, they are going to move with constant speed v only. So the gap between this one and two will remain a, because what will happen is by the time one comes to this position, this position, let us say the gap between them is a by two now. Now, like they collide at some distance a by two, one and two. After collision, when one reaches here, when one reaches the position of two, the two would have reached here. Okay, I'm considering as if one is going through two, and two is also going through one, and so by the time two reaches here, one will be, and one is moving this way. Now two also collides with the wall and it rebounds and it moves. So the gap between two and one will remain A, and gap between two and three will remain B. And gap between 3 and 4 also will remain, it will remain C only. Only thing is their directions are getting reversed because they are colliding with the wall and they go through the other bodies and move in split speed. Okay, so final state will be something like this. One will go through all these masses, it will go up, and 2 which is behind it will be behind it by a distance A. That will go through 3 and 4 because 2 will first hit the wall and then it will go through 3 and 4. Okay. And behind A, it will be behind 1 by a distance of A. And then 3 also will collide with the wall and will go through 4. Right? And then it will be behind 2 by a distance of B. Okay. So that way you can say that you have 4 masses finally which are going to be like this. Here the gap should be A, here it should be B, and here it should be A. The final is going to be like this. Okay, A, B, and C, and all are going towards right with speeds. Okay, but the thing is, like, this mass will be mass 1, this will be mass 2, this will be mass 3. This is the actual situation. In actual situation, the actual like collisions which are actually taking place, we can say that 1 will be the first mass on the left side and 4 will be the last mass on the right side. That's how it is going to be finally. But the directions of velocity for all the 4 of them have got reversed after all these collisions, and they have become like this. Okay. And as far as number of collisions are concerned, that also we can actually make out from this, because one will collide with the wall. That is one collision. Then after that, it will go through 2, 3, and 4. Going through 2, 3, and 4 is actually basically involving 3 more collisions. So it will have collisions with 2, 3, and 4. Okay? So that totals to 4 collisions involving 1. Then 2. 2 will have a collision with wall and then with 3 and 4. Because 2 will also go through. So that involves 3 more collisions. So 4 collisions, then 3 more collisions. And then for 3, we can consider 2 more collisions because 3 will collide with the wall and then go through. So 2 more collisions. And then 4, we can consider 1 collision before 1. So in total, we can say there are number of collisions are 4 plus 3 plus 2 plus 2. Okay, which will come out to be 10 collisions.
So can you tell how did you decide the separations, final separations?
How do you define the final separations?
Final separations are
the way we are viewing it. One collides with the wall and then moves back in the opposite direction. It goes through 2, 3 and 4. 2 also does the same. It collides with the wall and then goes through 3 and 4. 3 also collides with the wall and goes through 4. And then 4 collides with the wall and rebounds. So at any point of time between 1 and 2, the gap will be A. Between 2 and 3, the gap should be B, because they are going with same speeds. And between 3 and 4, the gap should be C. Okay. But now 1 is ahead of all. 1 is over here, 2 is behind it, 3 is behind it, and 4 is. Okay. So between 1 and 2, it is A. Between 2 and 3, it is B. And between 3 and 4.
Yes, thank you.
Okay. See, the thing is actually like maybe a little bit it's a sort of imaginative way of actually looking at the things. Okay, if you want to take all the facts in the way they are given and then solve it, then also you can do it, and you will still get the same results as we are getting it. Because if you have to do it like with the proper facts and just go according to collision by collision, if you want to see how the separations are changing and then how finally the final like separation is turning out to be something like this, you can do that. But in that case, you have to see collision by collision the positions of each of the four masses, and then you have to modify that from collision to collision, and then finally you will be able to establish what is the final state. Okay, like for instance, you can start off like this. As I told you, the first collision was after the first collision. Okay, we had here. I'm just showing arrow marks here. I'm not showing any V velocity and all that, because whether a collision takes place, whenever a collision takes place, velocity will remain. I think you can easily see, because here two types of collision can take place. One is with the wall. If the collision takes place with the wall, velocity will get reversed. Only that much will happen. Magnitude will not change. But if the collision takes place between the two walls, then also velocity will get reversed. So in all cases, we can say that all the four masses will retain their space. Okay, so I'm just showing the arrows here, arrows indicating the direction of collision. Okay, now we will come to the second collision. For second collision will take place exactly at midpoint of these, because they will move equal distances. Okay, so that means it should take place at A by 2 distance. Second collision, between 1 and 2. And 3 will be at distance B. And C will be at distance. 4 will be at distance C. Okay. So this is for like the second collision, second collision, which is taking place between 1 and 2. Okay. Now after the collision, 1 and 2 will move in opposite directions. 1 will move towards the wall and 2 will move towards the wall. Okay. Now let us assume here, I'm just going with an assumption that let us suppose that C is more than B is more than. Okay, right. Let us go with that assumption. We can take any assumption we want. I can proceed with that. Okay, C is more than B, more than A. Okay, even in that case also, like we can simply say that here, this B and A which we have here, separation between 2 and 3 is B, whereas here we have A by 2. Okay, so we can say that 1 will reach A by 2 and it will collide with the wall. So third collision will be between 1 and 1. And at that point of time, 2 will be at A distance. Because 2 also would have moved by A by 2 distance in the same time. So there will be A distance. 2 would have moved A distance. And therefore, between 2 and 3, the distance will be B by 2. You can say that between 2 and 3. Now since this has moved by a distance, this is moving with a velocity v, this is also moving with a velocity v. Both 2 and 3 are moving in opposite directions with velocity v now. After the collision, they are moving this way. So distance will become half. So it will be v by 2. And here it will be c. This is after third collision. Okay. Now after this third collision, we can say that B is 2 is still moving this way and 3 is still moving this way, 4 is moving this way and 1 is moving towards 2. Okay, now 1 and 2 are moving with same velocity. Therefore, separation between 1 and 2 will not change. It will remain A1. Okay, now 2 will collide with 3. Now 2 will collide with 3 because the distance between them is B by 2. Okay. So we can therefore say that this collision will take place at a distance of b by 4. 2 will move a further distance of b by 4. So it will be something like this. If 2 moves a distance of b by 4, then A also will move a distance of b by 4. Okay. A also should move a distance of b by 4. This is a plus b by 4. A plus b by 4. This is where 2 is, and 2 collides with 3.
Sir, between 2 and 3, shouldn't the separation be b minus a, sir?
Between 2 and 3?
Separation should be b minus a, no.
Separation should be b minus a.
Third collision.
Why b minus a?
2 has moved a by 2 by the time 1 has moved a by 2, no, sir. So 3 would also have moved a by 2. By the time 1 has moved a by 2.
Yeah, so here 1 has moved a by 2, so 2 also has moved a by 2. So 3 also should have moved a by 2. Yes, 3 also should have moved a by 2 in that case, because by the time 1 has come here, 2 would have come here, okay? And 3, which is a distance, would also have come here. So it should be at a distance of b by 2 minus a by 2. So this whole distance should be b by 2.
B minus a, sir.
B minus a by 2. Okay, b minus a by 2 will be the distance between 2 and 3 at the time when 1 collides with the 1.
It should be b minus a, sir.
B minus a by 2.
3 also moves a by 2 and 2 also moves a by 2.
So that's the
opposite minus directions.
B plus a by 2. B plus a by 2 is the whole distance, and then this has moved by a by 2. So the distance should be b only. Distance should be b only. It should be b only.
So 2 and 3 have moved a by 2 in opposite directions. No?
Yeah, so 2 has moved a by 2. 3 also has moved a by 2. So distance between 2 and 3 will be b. But distance of 3 from the wall will be b.
So distance between 2 and 3 has reduced by a, no, sir.
So it will be b minus a.
Yes, sir.
So I'm not contending that. What I'm saying is distance between 3 and wall will be b.
Okay.
And distance between 2 and wall will be a.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Right. So that was a third collision. And when fourth collision is going to take place, you can say that between 2 and 3, the gap which is b minus a will reduce. And both 2 and 3 would have moved by b minus a by 2. Okay. Both would have moved by b minus a by 2 now. Okay. So also would have moved by distance of b minus a by 2. Okay. And here there will be a gap of 2 and 3. This is for fourth position. Fourth position will have this. Now we know that between 1 and 2, the gap will remain A only. This gap will remain A only. Okay. So therefore, this whole distance will be A plus B minus A. Okay. A plus B minus A by 2. That will be B plus A. So 2 and 3 are at separations of B plus A by 2 at the time of fourth collision. And this gap should be C. Between 3 and 4, the gap should be C. Okay. So now at this point of time, 1 is moving like this. And 2 would be moving this way, and 3 would be moving this way, and 4 this way. I'm just considering just after the fourth collision, not just before the fourth collision. Just after the fourth collision, it will be C. Then you can consider the fifth collision. So after the fifth collision, we will have this thing. Now, fifth collision will take place between these two bodies. Here the gap is C, whereas here the gap is A, and here the gap is B minus A. Okay. Here the gap is B minus A by 2. So it would be between 1 and 2, there will be a collision. Okay, because you can expect that this gap of A would definitely be less than C, because here C is more than B is more than A. So we can consider that 1 and 2 are going to collide before 3 and 4 are. Okay, right. So we'll consider collision between 1 and 2, and that will take place exactly midway between these two points, midway between 1 and 2. Okay, so between B minus A by 2 and between B plus A. Okay, so so a point exactly midway between B minus A by 2 and B plus A by 2 will come out to be at a distance of B.
We'll get that at distance of b. B or b by 2?
B by 2, sir.
B by 2, no? Yeah, b by 2. Right? So exactly midway, if you are considering, it should be at a distance of b by 2. Okay? Because it should be b by 2 plus b minus a by 2. And the distance here, because this would have moved further by b by 2. So b minus a by 2 plus half of this we have to take. Okay. So we can say just the average of these two, that should be equal to b by 2. Okay. So this is the first particle. First particle will be here. Okay. And second particle will also be here only. They will be moving in opposite directions. Okay. First and second particles, they are moving in opposite directions this way. Okay. And the same point of time, during this time, when 2 has moved a distance of, there's a distance moved by 2, because from b plus a by 2, the separation, 2 has come to a position of b by 2, which means 2 must have moved a distance of a by 2. Because from b plus a by 2, it has come down to b by 2. That means it must have moved, like 2 moved through a distance of a by 2. Okay, when 2 has moved through a by 2, even 3 also will move through a by 2. So 3 would be somewhere. It will be at a by 2 distance. Maybe. This should be a by 2. Can we say that to be a by 2 or should it be a?
A.
A, right? See, because here the fact is that whatever distance a 2 has moved, twice that distance will be separation between 2 and 3. Because 3 also has moved the same distance. Okay. So now we know that 2 has moved through a distance of exactly the half of this. Now this distance was A. Okay. This was basically A. The separation between these two was A. So by the time they have collided, the separation between 2 and 3 also has increased to A. So there must be a separation of A here. So a plus b by 2, a plus b by 2 will be this whole position where we will have 3. Okay, and at that point of time, like where would 4 move? 4 would have moved some distance this way, because like by the time here 2, because you can say that it has come down from b plus a by 2 to b by 2. Okay, that means it has moved by a by 2. If by the time 2 has moved by a by 2, even 4 would have moved by a by 2. So 4 would be at a position of. Okay, so this whole distance, if you consider, it has also moved closer by. That means the gap between 3 and 4 has now become c minus. Okay. Because initially the gap between c and 3 and 4 was c. After the collision, 3 is moving like this way, 4 is also moving this way, and both of them together, they move a distance of a. Right? So the gap is going to reduce to c minus. Okay. Now after the collision between these two, 1 and 2, 1 is going to move towards the like the wall here, and 2 will move like this. Okay. Then we can have. Two is moving this way, and one, and now 2 and 3 both are moving in the same directions with speed v only. So 2 and 3 will not collide. Okay, 3 and 4 will collide because they are moving in opposite directions. Okay, and 1 would collide. 1 is a distance of b by 2 here. Okay, 1 would collide with the wall here. Okay, so we will consider here that suppose if 3 and 4 are going to collide. Okay, 3 and 4 are going to collide. So at the time when 3 and 4 are going to collide, then 1 would have like. Any point of time, we can say that by the time this collides, 1 will move through a distance b by 2, and 2 also will move through a distance b by 2. Okay, so if I consider 6th collision, that we can just consider that 1 is here, and 2 will be a distance of b.
2 is the distance of B. Okay. Now between 2 and 3, the gap will remain as A. And 2 and 3, the gap will remain like A. Okay. And we can also say that by the time 1 has moved from B by 2, even 3 also would have moved by a distance of B by 2. So 3 would have moved a distance of B by 2 towards 4. And 4 would also have moved a distance of B by 2, which means distance between 3 and 4 will reduce further by B. So therefore, distance between 3 and 4 would become C minus A. Distance between 3 and 4 will become C minus A minus B, because 3 and 4 are going in opposite directions towards each other. So the separation between them will reduce by B. Okay. So now and if the velocities are related like this, now we'll consider this a collision between 3 and 4. Okay. Because 1 and 2 are moving in same directions. So collision has to take place between 3 and 4 now. Seventh collision will be. That will happen when 3 has moved a distance which is half of this. That is C minus A minus B by 2. 3 has moved by a distance of C minus A minus B by 2. So this distance will be C minus A minus B by 2. And here the gap will be A between 1 and 2. 1 and 2 it will be B. And between 2 and 3 also the gap will be A. And 3 and 4 are. So after collision, 3 will move this way. Okay. So after 7th collision, this is what is happening. Now 4 will continue to move with velocity. Okay. Now gap between 2 and 3 is A, and gap between 1 and 2 is B, and here we have C minus A minus B. Okay. So next we can see that there should be distance between 2 and 3 is A. So there could be a collision between 2 and 3, okay? And after a collision between 2 and 3, 3 will move in same direction. 3 will move in the same direction. And now 2 will collide with 1, because there will then be a collision between 2 and 1. And then 1 will move this way and return. Okay, so for the next collision, we'll consider collision between 2 and 3. Eighth collision. Between 2 and 3. So 2 and 3 collision will take place when 3 has moved by A by 2, 2 also has moved by A by 2. Okay, when 3 and 2 are moved by A by 2 and A by 2 each, then separation between 3 and 4 also will increase to A. Okay, between 3 and 4 also separation should increase to A. So we can say that here 4 and between 3, there will be a separation. And collision between 3 and 4 is taking place. Okay. So in this process, you can say that 2 has moved by A by 2. And even 1 has moved by A by 2. 1 was also moved by A by 2. So if 1 moves by A by 2, we'll add A by 2 to C minus A minus B by 2. So if you add A by 2 to C minus A minus B by 2, right, you will get C minus B. One will be at C minus B. And between 1 and 2, the gap has to be B, because they are moving in same direction, so separations are not going to change. So gap will be between 1 and 2. Okay. So after collision, 2 will be moving like this and 3. Okay, now you can consider a collision between 1 and 2. Okay, for collision between 1 and 2, the gap between them is B. So both of them have to move by the distances of B by 2 each before collision distance. Okay, that means 1 will move a distance of B by 2. If 1 moves a distance of B by 2, the separation of 1 from the wall will become C by 2. Okay, so for 9th collision, you can consider that the separation between 1 and the wall is C by 2. 1 and the wall, it is C by 2. okay, and 2 and 1 are at the same location. Okay, 2 and 1 are at the same location, and you can say that 2 and 3 are moving in opposite directions. Now, because 2 has moved a distance b by 2, then 3 also would have moved a distance b by 2. When 2 has moved by b by 2, 3 also would move by b by 2. And in such a case, the gap between 3 will become b. So there should be a gap of b. And between 3 and 4, it will be. The gap between 3 and 4 is not going to change because 3 and 4 are going in same direction with same speed, so their gap is not going to change. So it will remain new. After 9th collision, it is going to be. Okay, now you can see that 10th collision will be between 1 and a wall. Between 1 and a wall, there will be a collision. And in order for that collision to take place, 1 has to travel a distance c by 2. In that time, 2 also will travel a distance c by 2. So distance between 1 and 2 will become c. Okay, so 10th collision will be this. After the 10th collision, both are going in same directions. Both 1 and 2 are going in same directions. And separation between 1 and 2 is c. And separation between 2 and 3, however, not changed. Between 3 and 4 also separation will be. That will remain b and. So after 10 collisions, you can see that between the masses, the separations are C, B, and A, and they all have same speeds. Okay, so step by step, if you see, like, after each collision, what are the respective positions, and if you try to, like, work this out, you can actually like show that it is the same as what I was discussing earlier. Because whenever an elastic collision takes place between two identical masses, it is as good as like one mass just moves past the other mass because the velocity is simply getting interchanged. Okay. Yep. Any doubts? Right. Okay then. So we'll meet in the next session then. So we'll close the session for now.